Saturday rules.
I can read this.
So tonight I am a sponsor. Who's going to be a sponsor? I'm an accountant. I'm a photographer. I'm an avid swimmer. I'm a board member for another national mental health organisation. I've been married to my good husband for 30 years and we have two wonderful sons. But enough about me. Whilst this is intense and personal in many ways, this is not really about me. I'd like to check with each of you when you hear the word sponsor. What image does that bring? When you hear accountant, do you create a certain picture in your mind? 30 years married, well, that's a rock solid creature. A photographer, creative, these bring blinded images into a person's when you hear those comments. So this coming Wednesday night, I'm also an exhibitor. And yes, that would mean I live with darkness and mental illness. I was 13 when the first person coming out. I was 13 when I was first diagnosed and prescribed a tonic, and that's a few years ago now, 40. I've no idea what was in it, but it made me feel terrific. And my life circumstance hadn't actually changed. So I thought this drug has masked the pain, so I stopped taking it, much to my mother's chagrin. So at the ripe old age of 13, I decided I would not be vulnerable, I would not be weak, I would cope, I would manage, I would keep busy, I would be resilient, and I did go on to actually develop a very strong sense of self-confidence that was born of just intense insecurity. I was and still am very good at what is termed presenting, aka pretending I'm fine, monitoring myself constantly so that I don't reveal any chinks in my armour, and that takes an enormous amount of energy. And of course, at some point, I had to run out of energy. This wasn't an uncommon event in my life, and I often became physically ill, which I still believe we do with more things that happen elsewhere. And that would force me to rest. I certainly knew that I struggled, but it became unavoidable when I had to face that I was physically, mentally, and emotionally exhausted. 25 years of struggling had taken its toll. So, of course, I fought the diagnosis for another 10 years in Vancouver. But to give you some idea of what this looks like, for me, making you some idea about how it might look for someone bigger. Firstly, the world is on the other side of this process. It might be data term, but it's a thick plastic. I can see, but it's not clear. There are shadows, and I can't read people nor interpret social situations very well. I become uncertain about how people close to me feel about me being like this. I can't feel their love. I hate being a concern to them. I become unsure of my decisions. I actually become uncertain to stop. And I can't seem to step past the first stage of the thinking process required to decide what I need to do to change the current situation. So to add to my confusion, a lot of the people around me have always seen me as confident, decisive, articulate, thoughtful, and I could go on. So they don't or can't believe how it can get me. And it can really go at me. So, however, in my mind, I'm none of those things. I've just been pretending, and this is where there is a very slippery slope into a very dark place that reminds me of the well in the movie The Ring, and that's nowhere anyone wants to go. But on that note, I can usually hold on to belief that this dark time will pass, which gives me hope in the present. Do you like that? So that's a little bit about me, and because of that, I feel so strongly about anti-stigma. I'm passionately involved with quite a number of things, and I thought, well, when people react to me like that, how do they react to other people? And I'm not vulnerable anymore. You know, when I was first diagnosed, I was general manager of Elder Care in Western Queensland, and had 40-odd staff. I didn't want that to be. So you hit a lot, and now I'm self-employed. I don't have employees, so I thought if this isn't a time that I can talk about it, they probably won't ever do it. So thank you for your attention.